Hi, welcome to the editorial office of the New England Journal of Medicine. My name is Jen Zeiss, and with me is the author of a recent study on opioids, Dr. Michael Barnett. Dr. Barnett, could you please introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about the study?
Yeah, so I'm an assistant professor of health policy and management at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. I'm also a primary care physician at Brigham and Women's Hospital. Our study that just came out looking at opioid prescribing by physicians and its long-term effects on patient outcomes was motivated to a large extent, like much of my research, about personal experience. A main research interest of mine is understanding quality of care, particularly in the overuse of medical services, and how healthcare systems and physicians influence the quality of care that's delivered. And my experience as a physician has been that I often don't have a lot of guidance around how I prescribe opioids, either how often or what doses I prescribe. And like many other primary care physicians, and you know, I think many doctors can sympathize with this, it's such a challenge to deal with patients who are on chronic opioids for pain management. I think there's accumulating evidence that they may not really be effective in the long term for patients, but once someone's on them, it's very hard to get them off. And we often struggle with how do we treat these patients' pain in the absence of opioid therapy. And so my interest really gravitated towards how does this start? What's the genesis of a patient turning into a chronic opioid user? And is there a moment that we can capture where they got that first opioid prescription that may or may not have actually even been evidence-based or may have depended based on the context they were seen? We came up, my authors, co-authors and I came up with the idea that in the emergency department, we actually have a natural experiment where once a patient goes to a facility, either by ambulance or they choose to go to a facility, there really isn't a lot of opportunity for them to choose the doctor they see. Either it depends on the shift that they happen to come, and that's the physician working that day, or maybe there are multiple physicians working in the emergency department that day, and they get assigned to one through a somewhat random process. And so we had a natural experiment there to look at physicians who might have different patterns of prescribing within the same hospital. And crucially, patients are actually more or less similar between the high prescribers versus the low prescribers, which is really what enables us to do our analysis. And the reason why this is important is because I feel like we're really missing the large-scale randomized control trial evidence that we have for so many other areas of medicine, like in heart disease or in asthma treatment, to really guide our treatment decisions. And one crucial question is, what is the risk of that initial opioid prescription for someone who may not otherwise be a chronic opiate user for developing chronic or long-term use? So the way we did the study is we took administrative claims data for Medicare patients who are generally older than 65 across the U.S. And our data covered all patients who had actually pharmacy claims through this program, Part D, within Medicare. It included nearly 400,000 patients in Medicare. And we classified physicians as either high prescribers or low prescribers depending on their prescribing patterns from 2008 until 2012. And these are all physicians who work in the emergency room. So the way that a patient got into our study is they saw an emergency physician for one visit during that period. And in the prior 6 months, they didn't have any opioid prescriptions at all. So we're trying to clean our data out of patients who were on chronic opioids beforehand. And the first thing that we found that we were quite surprised by was that high opioid prescribers gave opioids to patients they discharged home 24% of the time, nearly one in four patients, whereas low opioid prescribers gave opioids 7% of the time, or about one in 14 patients. And that's on average within a hospital. So we were pretty surprised by that disparity. All of us know that just statistically, you're going to find lots of random variation in how physicians do things, and that variation is going to depend very much on the context and the medical decision that you look at. But that was a greater amount of variation than even we had expected going into this. So then what we did is we followed patients out for the subsequent year who saw either the high prescribing doctors or the low prescribing doctors. And let me point out that these are patients that are in many ways randomly assigned to see one doctor or another. And so we found that they're quite similar between those two groups. and the doctors seeing the high prescribers were 30% more likely to develop long-term use over the next 12 months, which we defined as 6 or more months of filling opioids in the next year. And there are two important things to realize about that. So one is that this is not a trivial measure of long-term opioid use. It, for instance, in Massachusetts, you can only fill 30 days of opioids at a time. So that's someone who had to go back to a doctor, you know, more or less monthly, or at least interact with the healthcare system in some way monthly to get that opioid prescription, or at least twice. This really takes quite a bit of effort. The other thing is that other doctors had to continue that prescription. So it might be easy to point a finger at the emergency room doctor who is prescribing opioids to 1 in 4 patients, but other physicians, like primary care physicians like myself, needed to continue that prescription.
Dr. Rimmer, in your study, you mentioned something called clinical inertia. Is that what you're describing right now?
Yeah. So we talk about clinical inertia in our study as this concept that what we think might be happening, a way to explain how do patients get that initial prescription and turn into long-term users, is that, you know, I think as a physician, when I have someone come into my office that I may not know or I don't know that well, and they have a prescription, they have a set of prescriptions they're already on, and in general, people are usually, you know, they're doing fine, or they're not necessarily complaining about the medications they're on. You know, there's a lot of inertia there to just continue things the way they're going. If an emergency physician sends my patient home, and then they come back to see me and they're taking 5 milligrams of oxycodone 4 times a day, you know, it's, am I going to, you know, what's going to motivate me to change that prescription to oxycodone twice a day? Or to decrease the dose from 5 milligrams to 2.5. It may happen, but the default is going to be, let's just simply continue what you have, because that's just cognitively easy.
Okay, and something that, was there an opportunity to do a study like this with a different patient population, or is there, tell me about how you picked this particular patient population.
Yeah, so I think the what made this study possible is really using the emergency room, and so, you know, because patients don't really choose their doctors, it gives us this kind of I hesitate to say randomized controlled trial because there's lots of, you know, statistical nuances to to what we did that don't meet the high threshold of a randomized controlled trial. But it helped us address a lot of the issues of selection bias, where patients who want opioids are going to be attracted to doctors that they think are more likely to prescribe opioids. And I think many of us have also experienced this, of patients who may storm out of our office if we're not willing to prescribe an opioid. You know, it's something that happens. It's not just a theoretical concern.
Mm-hmm.
And so in other settings, for instance, if we wanted to do this among, say, primary care doctors, patients are very much going to be attracted or drawn away from physicians that may not meet their preferences in terms of pain management and prescribing.
Mm-hmm.
And so it'd be very hard to replicate a trial like this, a study like this, looking at different prescribing rates among primary care doctors.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, you said a lot. So what do you think, personally, what do you think are the implications for both doctors and patients from your study?
Yeah. So one thing is, I think that I'd love to see a lot more evidence around how we prescribe opioids in the most common clinical situations. So for instance, there was a trial published a couple years ago that randomized patients with acute low back pain to getting either oxycodone or a muscle relaxant on top of standard naproxen therapy, and found actually that neither the muscle relaxant nor the oxycodone was actually more effective at decreasing pain or disability scores. And I think that's the kind of evidence that really helps us counsel patients who might be expecting an opioid or think that that's the only thing that can address their pain to say, look, I know that this is a medication that that you want right now, but actually we've learned that it actually can be more dangerous than effective.
Mm-hmm.
That being said, it's easy for me to claim we need evidence for everything. Like, I think that's an easy thing to say. And I think in the absence of that, I think we, as physicians, even within a health system, can still get together and say, okay, guys, let's look at how often we prescribe opioids as a group and say, you know, for the folks who are the very top end versus the bottom end, you know, tell us about how you got there, and is there kind of a best practice that we can agree on,
mm-hmm.
Both so our patients get a consistent message, and also as a group of physicians, we have a sense of the type of care that we'd like to deliver to patients. So I think those are two things that I'd say on the provider side. One other thing on the provider side, I think, is getting better education in the training setting, so for residents and for medical students. There's a really promising initiative in Massachusetts, actually. All the medical schools in Massachusetts, they published a paper in Academic Medicine and published guidelines on the state government website around a new opioid and pain management curriculum that they're going to require for medical schools, and I hope that also residency programs can adopt it as well, which I think is also going to be crucial.
And my last question is, in the New York Times today, you told an interesting personal vignette about your experience after doing the study, and I thought maybe everyone would like to hear something like that.
Sure. So, you know, one other implication that I didn't mention is that I think, you know, I really can speak for myself,
sure.
Though I think there is also some survey data recently published by the Washington Post and Kaiser Health News that backs this up, which is that a lot of patients who get prescribed opioids aren't really educated about the risks of dependence or addiction by the physicians who first prescribed them. Now, whether or not that education is effective or would decrease the rate of opioid prescribing is not something that we know, but I think properly counseling patients about the risks of medications we prescribe is kind of a perennial issue. And so one lesson I took away from the study is I should be telling my own patients more often that if I'm giving you this prescription, you know, it might lead to dependence, and it could be hard to get you off of this medication. Actually, last Friday, just last week, I saw a patient who had just fallen down the stairs because it was very slippery and icy, and really harmed her back. But there was no fracture, nothing really acutely wrong that needed to be, you know, fixed surgically. But she was just really suffering. She was in such pain; she could barely get out of the chair, and you know, she couldn't get to school. Just wasn't sure how she was going to get through the weekend. And I decided, you know, against my better judgment, like that the only way I was going to be able to really treat her pain effectively, because she had tried a fairly potent over-the-counter cocktail, was to prescribe her some narcotics. As I was going into the room, I told myself, oh, this paper's coming out. You know, like I probably should tell this person about the risk of dependence and addiction.
Right.
As I was telling her about it, it was just strange how foreign it felt to me. That it actually wasn't something I really had mentioned to patients.
Right.
Like how many times have I prescribed opioids before? And this wasn't something that I just was used to saying. It wasn't one of my kind of stock speeches.
Right.
And I think to me that was a lesson that we can really be quite unaware of the habits we have as physicians. Sometimes you really do need a jolt to remind you how to change your normal status quo of practice.
Thank you. So we will be doing a Twitter chat on the 28th of February with Dr. Barnett, another author, and other invited participants, as well as hopefully you. So if you have questions about this study or anything that you want to discuss, please join us on the 28th. We would love to see you. And thank you so much, Dr. Barnett,
okay,
for coming
you.
And discussing your paper.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.